Welcome back. We're glad you're watching The Business Show with me, Simon. Now, feel free to get in touch with us on our social media handles right below your screen. Tell us what you think about the show and some of the topics that you think need to be discussed on how you can grow your business and the different challenges. We know for a fact that the central bank rate now stands at 9%, which is seemingly simply telling us that, look, the banks are going to hold up more money because if you cannot pay, then there's no need of them giving you that money. Let's talk how to make money. Now, for several farmers, you know, keeping or rearing animals is just a conversation that goes around, let's keep it for milk because the market is available. But did you know that you could actually rear cattle for beef? The market is very open and it's huge for those of you out there. So it's important for you to pay attention to the tips that are given by experts. And this week, on how to make money, we speak to one of the experts who tells us what you need to do to make some money off rearing cattle for beef.
My name is Godfrey Akabura. I work with Nagri Kandibi and I'm stationed in Entebbe. Under beef, there are many breeds of beef cattle, all over the world. Starting from maybe the Boran, which are here in East Africa, especially Kenya and Uganda. We've got the Brahman, we've got the Ramanura, we've got what we call the Charolais. There are many. Here at our store, at the beef store, we only have the Boran, which are here in Uganda, and they are under management of Nagri, which is the body which is in charge of livestock breeding, improvement, commercialization, conservation of indigenous genetics, fish inseminations, and maturation embryo transfer technologies in the country. Doing beef as a business, one, you need to look at the breed of the animal, the system of production, then the available feed resources, then you can start from there. Usually the beef, when we talk of beef, we do consider much of, you know, land. However, you can do what we call the feed rotting, and you have a shed like this one, you confine them, you formulate your ratios, and you do the store feeding and the feed rotting. And a normal environment when it is well fed, these animals, especially the Boran, Brahman, can be putting something like 800 grams per day. You need to have taken the weight and you need to monitor that from day one, maybe because for business, you may not rear them up to 2 years. You can have them just for 1 year, 1.5 years, starting from even 6 months. There are systems or categories. Then you feed them accordingly. Now, depending on the breed that one is rearing, it will determine the profitability. One who is doing the Boran and Brahman and the Ramanura, those are good animals that do put actually a lot of flesh. So that meaning they reach the slaughter market at an early age, and the quality of the meat or the carcass can really meet the standard market standards. Now that implies that if I have, when you look at the marketplace of meat, maybe something like 10,000, and this animal, the body weight, they are giving it around 500 kgs. So if you take, there is a way how we calculate the carcass weight. We call it dressing carcass percentage. If you take something like 53 or 55 out of 400 or 500, and you have average like 250, that is carcass weight. Now the carcass weight, meaning that you've slaughtered, there is no skin, you've emptied the rumen, everything. It is now just meat. You're looking at now the meat, then you get that 250 carcass weight, you multiply by that 10,000 and you're good to go. You're in something like 2.5, 3 million in that range at an RAH. Now, of course, now you can go back and think of all these enterprises and the livestock, they make money. But one needs to understand the gestation period indeed. One has to incorporate in something like patience in this. A poultry farmer will earn money at even day one. The goats at maybe at the age of 1 year or six, something like 6 months, they have growers and have kids, he or she can sell and generate money. The one operating pigs or piggery production at 3 months or 114 days, he or she would have gotten the piglets. Maybe after 1 month, he or she can sell and get money. Those are gestation periods now. The dairy and beef, their gestation period, one, by the time, like a dairy or this one, by the time they conceive to give birth, that is like at around 24 months, that is when they start giving birth. That means within the period of 2.5 to 3 years, that's when I'm starting to get some money from dairy. For these ones, I may not wait to have 3 years because this is a fattening program. I need meat and then I need money. So I can decide. There are those who are doing that, like from weaning to fattening now. There I can sell. Weaning, it can happen after 6 months, you wean, you send those bulls or the beef animals to the fattening program, the feed rods now. They are fed past 1 year, then targeting a certain weight. I may say, for me, my Borans or Brahman or Amanira, I will sell them when they've attained like maybe 400 kgs live weight, and when they can attain that, maybe when they are 1.5 years, depending on the feeding program you've given them. Remember, they are beef, you can do what we call a drip feeding or a drip bottom, whereby you give them feeds 24/7, targeting a certain weight at a certain period. So it depends. The available sources of feeds, also the system of production, and the breeds, your money, and your program of the project. I can decide even at 1 year, I will be disposing them of. At 2 years still, there is what we call pelleted feeds or concentrates, and there is what we call the cattle nuts. These are good whereby, of course, now for these ones, these are beef, and we are targeting fattening. So that means I'm going to look at my formula, and then I increase the amount of that feed resource that is giving too much fat, that can increase the fat content on them. Then I increase the ration that. If they are in open grazing, that is ranching, then I ensure that I have enough pastures. But it is always advisable, if you're doing it as a business, you can have the feed rod whereby there is no movement, there is no wastage of energy. So everything is put into production and you're feeding them adequately so they are content. By 6 months, when you're looking at like the Brahman, by 6 months, I mean 6 months, they will be just early wind, 280 to 300 kgs live body weight. They must have attained that. Then by the time they reach 1 year and a half, then they go up to 400. That is if they are well fed. Yes, the Ramanura the same. This Boran, by that time they can be still 150, 200 at 6 months. To first weigh it. So the parameters that we take when we're developing the feed ratios, one, we look at the body weight, live body weight. After that, when it is beef, I just need the age and the system now. I only need just the weight. If it is 400, that is live body weight, I can decide to give it, usually they are giving it 3% of its body weight. It's like now Uganda was hit with a lot of dry spells. But these animals, you can look at them, even outside in our farms, they are looking good. They can still come back and pick up. Unlike some of the exotic, too much exotic, and especially looking at dairy. Then when we look at the crosses, we have the crosses now, the Cemento and Brahman crosses. We're looking at now crossing Brahman, Cemento, Boran with Ankore. Remember, when we are crossing, we're looking at some of the desirable traits to be passed on to the offsprings. So the Brahman is a beef. Our Ankore, it is a typical local animal, an indigenous here. It is resistant and tolerant. The Brahman puts on too much weight. What does that mean? That the Brahman is going to pass over the genetics or that desirable traits of high growth rate, reaching maturity at an early age, onto that offspring. Then also the Ankore will have that contribution now of resistance and tolerance to the environment. We need money. We need to improve livelihood. And when you look at the demand, say like the demand of, you know, meat demand, like export, by the time if they want maybe like a ton of meat from like each and every farmer, and you're rearing a zebu or an Ankore, a mature one will weigh around, the Ankore will weigh around 400, 450, the mature one. The zebu will be around 300, 350, and that is a good one. the carcass will be less than that. So what does that imply? This one is weighing around 500 when it is at 3 years. It will go up to something like 650 when it goes to four and a half years. That means I may have at least 50% of that carcass weight. That means I can easily at least contribute and generate some good money when I'm having the improved genetics than someone who is in too much rock.
So there you have it. Look for opportunities available. And the market is, of course, here locally, but also across the region. You can feel free to get in touch with us in case you feel there's any info that you need about particular segments of this show, more so how to make money, which we think is something that should be changing the different perspectives for farmers. Okay, let's talk personal finance tips this week. And in our final episode of Augustine Tamale and the Tips, we're discussing multitasking as a way out to make more money. If you're doing a job that ends about 5 p.m., as a young person, why go home and rest? If you can take on something else that can help you make more money, just go ahead. Times are hard, man. You just need to do something else to raise more money. This is Personal Finance Tips for this week.
Hello, Augustine Tamale, my name's. Still navigating in the tough times is what we are looking at, with a focus more on individuals, but businesses can also pick a leaf. Of course, for businesses, you could consider hedging, agreeing on the foreign exchange contracts earlier on. You could sign a forex hedge of probably 3,850 shillings per US dollar, such that you are shielded. Even when it is 3,900, you have an agreement with the bank, they're still selling to you at the other agreement you've had. So businesses can also find a way of navigating. But as individuals, how many jobs are you doing? Are you doing only one job? Is there another one you can do in the evening? You see, when you read the book of Ecclesiastes, you can see that work in the morning and in the evening, don't let your hands rest. Sow a number of seeds, for you don't know which one will profit you. In a conversation with a young man who handles electrical matters, but is also a physics, mathematics teacher, he was concentrating on only the electrical matters to earn his income. And I told him, but you still have a qualification as a physics teacher. Can't you teach physics? And he looked around and got a school where he can teach early morning. They didn't have a physics teacher for their A-level. So early morning, 7 a.m., he's teaching physics because they have now to adjust to his program since they don't have a teacher. So 7 a.m. he's teaching physics, 8 a.m. he's moving to his routine job. So that has added on to his income. So how many jobs are you doing? Abroad, people can do more than one job. In Uganda, we relax. You do a job and then in the evening at 5, you say, oh, I'm worn out, and you go and you relax. When you go abroad, you have to work hard. Otherwise, your liquidating of your assets to get that visa is useless when you don't earn something sensible. So people work hard, changing from one job to another. Can we get that culture while here at home? Can't we put in more? What else can you do after your work? Are you able to do something in a supermarket, in a retail outlet? Are you able to do something in a pharmacy? Probably you work that shift of 8 p.m. to 11 p.m. Can't you dispense those drugs? Maybe you have that qualification in pharmacy, you have that diploma. Now you've spent the day working somewhere, in the evening you pass by a pharmacy and you are the one at the counter. Why can't you do that? It can help you to ably add up whatever you need to do, and then your income increases. But in the evening, you're on leisure, just either you are drinking something or you are watching a soccer match in the evening. These soccer matches, we can find later, they are replays. You can find them later. Can't you add on something extra to do? Or right in your home, if you are in the town, some urban farming of the sort, so that there's something you are doing in the evening. Don't just go home and sit. There should be some extra income. Are you an accountant? There are businessmen who don't know how to organize their books of accounts. Why don't you offer them that service? After work, your regular job, your day job, in the evening, you are preparing the books for some trader who doesn't know. So they give you their checkbook, they give you their bank statement, their receipt book and invoice book, and you start putting together their books. It will help you instead of just going home and you get into leisure. Do something extra so that your income increases. Let me say, this is a time of minimizing expenditure as well. In which school are your children? Isn't it time to change it if you can't afford it? Are you going to run crazy? Because again, borrowing for school fees is suicidal. It doesn't add to the inflow of money. I believe in borrowing for medical emergency, borrowing for investment. That's what I believe in. If you are borrowing to pay school fees, tuition for your children, that is suicidal. Children are not an income project. If it's a good school, you needed it. But these are tough times. Isn't there a moderate one to which you can change? This is a time to think through. Where are you renting? Isn't that apartment too expensive? It may be time for you to shift now and get into an apartment that's probably lower. What about your transport means? Have you evaluated them? Is it cheaper for you to use public means or to drive to work? Or to ride to work, which one is cheaper for you? Look through and see the option that is going to work for you, so that the cost you have in order to get to your workplace or to your business premises can be adjusted downwards during these tough times. It's not a must to drive. And if at all two of you are driving, why can't you move early and you use one vehicle? Why should the two of you drive? Think through these things and be able to reduce on your expenditure. That is very, very key for you to reduce on your expenditure. What about the type of work you are doing? Is that the only thing you can do? Maybe you need now to change. This may not be the only thing you can do in life. Probably it's time for you to change vocation and do something else that can earn you some sufficient amount of money, or something that you can do nearer to home such that you minimize on transport.
Now, if you drive, or literally everyone that is engaged in business uses fuel, and you notice that the prices for now look to be constant at about 6650. But the interesting thing is that as a car owner, you might need to check out the state of your car, because then that could also help you cut down on how much fuel you use. Do you service on time? Such things can help you maximize on the liters given the such times that things look more tricky. That and more in the roundup of fuel prices across major cities in the country. Now, for those of you that are looking to trade across the region, let's just take a look now at how the Forex and the shilling generally fared on the market. That and more in our Money Markets report. And before we go, we had some stories that did make headlines in the world of business. Of course, we know the central bank rate moving up to 9%, and also the trade fair for women coming up. But what more stood across the world of business? Uganda to import 60 megawatts of electricity from Kenya. Farmers worried as produce prices increase. Uganda's Nile perch stocks declined by 62% in 1 year. You will to host a third COMESA Women Trade Fair. Pride Microfinance to train 1,000 youths in business. And Bold switches to corporate clients only in Tanzania. You know what? That should then surely do for this week's edition. Thank you so much for making time. Feel free to get back in touch and tell us what you think about the show. Also, the pages are open. The social media handles are right below your screen. You can tweet me directly. I'm at S Octel. But before I go, just listen to this. We buy things we don't need with money we don't have to impress people we don't like. Like the kind of guy that spends money on things you don't actually need simply because you want to hurt someone. You need to think as a business person. Invest money where you're sure you are going to recoup profits. Okay, times are hard. You can't take chances with money. You take care of yourselves. We'll see you soon. Bye for now.